So today we're going to talk about reverse searing, which is one of the techniques that I recommend. One of the key things about cooking meats, it really doesn't matter what the meat is, to be honest, okay? In regards to the application of heat and all the knowledge you need, it's actually pretty simple. One of the key things you need to understand is how the protein strands run. They run vertically, horizontally. Secondly, if the meat would really benefit from moist or dry heat applications. And additionally, whether you want to take a piece of meat to just done or past done. So imagine this, okay? So we just finished cooking these four backstraps, very different sizes, okay? These backstraps were taken between 120 and 125 degrees. They're gonna raise up as we're talking and resting, and then we're gonna have a little chat, about another 3 degrees. You'll notice that the big ones that I pulled off first are tented here. They're just in the rest period right now. And when I mean tenting, they're open on each end. We don't want to actually close this up because it's gonna steam out. It's gonna get a little soft. So the little ones that just came off, we're gonna cover them up in just a minute, let some of that hot, hot, intense air get off of them. And so basically we've done a two-stage process in order to get these back straps cooked appropriately. So we've got two different Traegers. I am one of Traeger's pit masters. I have been using their grills for 14 years. I've owned 65 barbecues. It is my world. Everything from big offsets to small little Lodge cast iron ones, everything in between. Right now I only have 18, which is the lowest number of grills I've ever owned. 16 out of those 18 are Traegers. So if you have questions about that, I got you, okay? One of the things is that as we were doing, or getting to see a beautiful demonstration on how to cut your meat and cut out hindquarters and all the other pieces, which is awesome. One of the great things, yeah, shut up, Jay. One of my buddies, just before you think I'm rude, okay? One of my Texas buddies. One of the things is that we were talking about the different cuts of meat, and the gentleman said, you know, if it was a top round, I would never put it on the grill. And I said, I'm gonna respectfully disagree, because not all grills are created equal. So the first thing you need to understand, these aren't your typical grills, okay? For anybody who has not had an experience with this, and it's not a sales pitch, I just wanna tell you why this grill makes things a little different, especially for game meats, okay? Very specifically for game meats. Traeger has two Instagram channels, only two. Traeger Grills and Traeger Outdoors, okay? Because the outdoors and outdoors food are so beneficial of the type of heat that we provide in regards to the grills. So basically the grill is this. We've got a beautiful grill. It's got a pill design. So most grills have circular, you know, barrel designs. Our grills don't anymore. They actually have a pill design. So that actually enables the smoke to travel within the chamber in a figure eight configuration. Additionally, we have actually an angled drip pan. This one's still on because we're going to cook the shoulders next. So after I'm done this, actually David, my best bud over there, he's soaking off the shoulders. We're cleaning them up from that demo right there. We're going to season them up right after this and start cooking them for tomorrow's event. But basically we have an angled drip pan, and that angled drip pan protects 92 to 93% of the grill surface. So it's all indirect cooking, okay? So remember, that's a more gentle, non-direct flame way of cooking any of your meats. Secondly, if you guys can hear that, that's the fan. It's actually helping with the distribution of the hot air that's actually blowing on the pellets as they combust within the hot pot. Now, as that hot pot is, you know, turned up or lower, it delivers more of the wood pellets, which is what we cook on. It's 100% wood. My logs are just really small and really consistent, okay? That's all they are. They're really small and they're really consistent. And we've got like 14 flavors. So today, because I thought it was appropriate, we're using Big Game Blend, okay? So this one is a combination of oak, and all the ingredients are always on the bag as well. So we've got hickory, oak, and a little bit of rosemary. And that gives a good flavor for all game meats. You know, rosemary always pairs typically very well with deer meat, but it's a really gentle, indirect way to cook things. The additional part of this is it's not a smoker. I always try to correct people. It's not a smoker. It's a wood-fired grill because we go everything from 165 degrees up to 500 degrees. This is literally a tabletop, you know, version of that one. This one here is called the Ranger, and we actually have the Scout over there, I think, on the auction table. We have a Scout over there. This one actually comes with the option of a cast iron insert. So as you saw, I did the smaller backstraps on the cast iron just to give a different texture as well. So the reason we do reverse searing, whether you're doing steaks, big double thick cut pork chops, anything like that, when it comes to reverse searing, we're trying to keep the protein strands as full of myoglobin as possible. So when the protein strands are assaulted with high heat, so that's all your individual cell structures. So your cells are built up of amino acids. They come together, they make the protein strands all tightened up. And when you put it on a hot grill, it's like slamming it together. And what happens then is that all that juiciness, all that delicious, you know, myoglobin that's inside any meat, whether it's a pork chop or a deer, literally gets expressed out. So our job with reverse searing, and why we go after reverse searing, is actually to keep that myoglobin, as much of that juicy goodness, as much of that delicious flavor in the meat itself. We don't ever want a dry piece of meat. The whole point of us, you know, hunting, in my world at least, because I love venison, okay? I love the way it tastes. It depends on the season and depends on the deer and who's, you know, doing the cutting, but usually it's quite good, right? But juicy meat always tastes better. So by the application of indirect heat, we get our backstraps or our pork chops or our steaks, and we're gonna grab a barbecue rub, okay? Or it could be something as simple as salt and pepper, but we kind of went with the whole program of big game today, okay? So this one has a little bit of sugars in it. It's got cane sugar in it, it's got some sea salt, it's got some herbs, and this is what I chose today to do with all of our game meats. There's a whole bunch of different rubs on the market. You guys know that, right? You walk in any grocery store these days, you can find a ton. I'm a big fan of this one because it's got the paprika. It's got a little bit of sweet. You know, venison, especially backstraps, go well with a little touch of sweetness, with a little bit of acidity balance. So we take the backstraps after we've trimmed them out. And by the way, these backstraps are really special. This is your CEO's daughter. She actually got all four of these. And I thought I was going to have to do, this is your daughter's backstraps, right? And I thought I was gonna have to come in today and trim. And I opened that bag and they were beautifully trimmed. And thank you very much, sir, I appreciate that. And so basically you wanna grab your piece of backstrap or your burger or your, you know, whatever you got, okay? You wanna also do something. Most people recommend you raise the temperature up, right? The internal temperature. And they'll say, leave your meat at room temperature before you go to the grill. I'm gonna tell you that's the worst thing you can do if you've got a Traeger grill or a wood-fired grill. And the reason is this, if you raise the temperature up of any of your meats, okay, the whole point of having a wood-fired grill is that I don't cook on gas, okay? Gas has no flavor. It doesn't give me anything, doesn't add any flavor. And the whole point of having a wood-fired grill is the fact that I want some of that wood-fired goodness to literally pair beautifully with my game meats, right? So if you go to your fridge and you take your meat out and you put it on the counter to let it raise up in temperature, you've actually reduced the opportunity in which to develop this stuff on the outside. You guys know what this is called? It's called bark, okay? It's literally the caramelization of the surface and the protein waters that come to the surface, and it makes that delicious crust on the outside of all meats. So one of the key things is that if you're working on a wood-fired grill, what you wanna do, not juicy at all, by the way, as you can see, what you wanna do is you always wanna go cold to cooker. So you take your meat out of the fridge, you season it up. You can put it back in the fridge overnight if you really want. I don't think it's such a good idea, because the second you hit any piece of meat with anything salt related, what happens? You start drawing out moisture, right, once again. So a lot of times, unless you're trying to break the proteins earlier, I would highly recommend you take your meat out of the fridge, season it up, or go right to the grill, okay? Our job, once again, is to keep as much moisture in that meat as possible and cook it as evenly as possible. So once you get it all seasoned up, whether you're using a big game rub or whatever you're using at home, you go to your grill. Now, when you go to your grill, you need to go to your grill low and slow, because what we're trying to do is infuse it with all that smoke flavor and not assault it with a lot of high temperatures. So we can go anywhere from 165 degrees indirect to 225 degrees indirect. That's about as high as you want to go. Now, second thing is this, for tools. You got a good grill, you got some great meat, you need to have some good tools. This is a digital thermometer called a ThermoPen. You guys have these? You all should have these, okay? One of the key things that I teach is repeatable, consistent results. It doesn't matter if this backstrap, you asked earlier, how long does it take, right? We were talking about this earlier, and I said, it depends on the meat. A lot of times I said, until it's done. Because every piece of meat breaks down differently. Every piece of meat could be a different thickness. You could have one that's an inch thick. You could have, you know, maybe you got a payday deer, okay? Maybe for some reason your backstrap ended up being this big, okay? Maybe you had a smaller deer. Maybe your backstrap is only this big. So it's not a matter of time, okay? So when we write recipes, we don't write to recipes based on time alone. We actually write recipes with temperature, okay? That way you guys can all have consistent, repeatable results every single time. Because if you cook by temperature, then you're not getting into that guesswork. You guys ever see that thing with steaks? You see that steak thing and they tell you that if you want a steak and you should go like this, and you go, this is medium rare, this is medium, this is well done. I have fat, fleshy hands, okay? Let me explain to you. When you got fat, fleshy hands, you're gonna always be medium rare, okay? It's no joke, that's the truth. And this girl here is like a buck 90, buck two, maybe, okay? So her hands are gonna be well done all the time because she got no fat, okay? Just a tiny little thing, okay? You see what I mean though? So that's a bull crap kind of thing, and I would not recommend that. However, I would rely on this, okay? So we get to the grill and we go to our grill low and slow. And the first segment of doing this will be a low and slow segment. And we're gonna take it to the internal temperature of 105 degrees. Okay, 105 degrees, we're not done yet, but we've completed the smoking component of it, okay? At that point, you can let the meat rest and you can cook it on the second section if you want, or you can, like what we did today, we put it in the Cambro while you guys were having lunch, we waited. It rested for a little bit in the Cambro, which is just our hot hold unit that David's sitting on right now. And then we came out to hotter grills, right? Because up to that point, what were we doing? Low and slow, getting that wood-fired infused flavor inside that meat. And it doesn't matter what the cut of meat is, okay? Low and slow, but we still want to get that great texture on the outside, right? We want to get that finish. So the second stage of that, after it gets to 105 degrees, we're going to go to the grills and we're going to crank them up 375 or higher. And the reason we're going that high is that we want to caramelize sugars on the outside. That's why those meats have that color. It helps caramelize the sugars, and you put them back on the grill directly, and you're going to take them to anywhere from 120 to 130 degrees. As we all know, or as we all should know, if you are serving well done backstrap, you are wrong. Really wrong, okay? Please make a ground beef patty and give me your backstraps, because I'm really thinking that's a disservice to the animal, in all honesty, okay? And I think it's like a sin. I'm pretty sure it's a sin at this point, okay? And then, what we're doing next is waiting. You guys saw me take them off. We were temping them, making sure they got to the right temperature. So once you get up anywhere from 120 to 130 degrees, the last stage is this right here. This is actually one of the most important stages. I can't stress this enough. I know you're hungry. I know you had a work day all day, okay? Maybe you're stressed out because every time you turn on the news, some shit storm is happening, okay? I understand, okay? But you still need to let your meat rest, okay? I know the kids are probably screaming at you. Actually, this one seems very polite, by the way, okay? Does he hunt? Are we starting? See, this is important. Kids need to do this stuff, okay? They really do. You can help him do this. He can come up and season stuff and sprinkle stuff, and it's awesome. I love that kind of stuff. So the next part is this part right here, and we are resting our meat, okay? So today, we started off this morning. The first stage for the large backstraps took almost 55 minutes. This is an investment in our time, right? You only get two backstraps, right, per deer? I think they're worth your time and investment. I also think this also works really well, by the way, for a lot of other cuts of meat, okay? But especially with backstrap. It breaks my heart when I see posts of people making jerky out of backstrap. I'm sorry, it breaks me into pieces. I literally want to text them and say, give me your back, I will ship you other meat to use, okay? But I really think that reverse searing backstraps is one of the very best ways to keep a whole intact piece of meat and elevate it with flavor and flavor profiles. And remember, we've done the basic big game rub today. We've done the basic, you know, coating of that. The other thing I would highly recommend when you go to the grill is get yourself one of these. This is a Dollar General spritz bottle. So you have to sanitize it first, okay? One of the things is that spritzing your meat when it goes to the grill, a wood-fired grill, will enhance the wood-fired flavor. Smoke is water soluble. There's a wonderful, wonderful meat scientist called Dr. Joseph Codray from the University of Iowa Meat Sciences program. He loves meat and he loves barbecue. He also loves game meats. And he has done extensive, you know, scientific research in regards to maximizing smoke penetration, denaturing of the proteins, which is just a fancy way of saying the proteins are breaking down. And basically, one of the key things is when we first go to the grill, that meat should be somewhat damp, because that dampness will actually encourage the flavor, that smoke that's traveling within the chamber, to stay on the meat itself. You guys know that if you have a grill at home and if you grilled something or if you smoked something, the next day it's a lot smokier flavored. And that's because the water molecules has risen to the top and actually soaked back into the cell structure. Okay, that's what we're trying to achieve by, you know, a single cook. So, to go through the steps again, cold from the fridge, number one. Number one, cold from the fridge, okay? Season it up. Not seasoning in the night before, okay? A dry seasoning literally minutes before. Go to the grill, anywhere from 165 degrees to 200 to 225 degrees maximum. And we use a digital thermometer or use the digital probe that comes on some of our units. And you're looking for approximately 105 degrees, 100 to 105 degrees. That's the first temperature. Once you've removed your meats from the grill, let them rest, lightly covered, ends open, tented slightly. Bring the internal temperature of your grill up, 375 or higher. Once your grill has come up to temperature, which is about 15 minutes typically for most units, you're gonna put your meat back on the grill and you're gonna finish it anywhere from 120 to 130 degrees. That entire process today, for at least the larger ones, was right around 75 minutes, 80 minutes, somewhere in there. And I truly believe that if you are going to only get two backstraps, or whatever you get for your year, you better invest your time because you invested your entire hunting season on that, right? Depending on how many tags you got. So that is my process for cooking the game meat. This sauce here, hey Kip, I don't know where Kip went, I lost Kip. This recipe is gonna be on the QDMA website, okay? At our Field to Fork event, where I got to play in the kitchen a lot, this is a sauce I have been making for a good solid 10 years. This is a blueberry rosemary reduction sauce, okay? It's blueberries and blackberries go beautifully with venison. They really do pair. It's got a little bit of sweetness. It's got a little bit of acidity in it. For 9 pints, you guys know that's a lot, right? 9 pints. This is what it gets reduced down to. That's it, okay? So it is a bit of an investment. It's a really good sauce. The website will have the recipe on it. So we're gonna make sure that that's available to everybody because it's multi-staged and multi-layered. And it has got some beautiful, beautiful flavors of rosemary in there. And like I said, that sweetness and the acidity. Now, once we've got our meats, can you grab the other rosemary and the blueberries out of the...
How long does that keep?
Well, I actually put it in the freezer. You know why? Because we're not in commercial units, okay? I'm the queen of freezer, okay? I really am. And by the way, 90% of my storage containers are these ones at home. If you guys know, who has that cupboard of death? The Rubbermaid cupboard of death where the lids all fall out and you're always trying to search for different lid size. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, I eliminated that crap a long time ago, okay? All of my containers are either the meal prep size, the little rectangles. You buy them in stacks of 20 because we all think we're going to be healthy and then a donut comes along and, things happen. But we have good intentions at least. So we know that all those lids fit, right? So those are one lid. And then on Amazon or Websteron, you guys have this wicked, awesome ordering and you don't have to be a business here in Georgia. So for anybody who's native to Georgia, I order so much stuff from it's called Websteron. One of the best online resources if you're looking for pans, if you're looking for foil, if you're looking for Ziploc bags, if you're looking for any restaurant supplies, including these little containers, and they come in four or five different sizes. The best part is all the lids fit every container, okay? So that's why you see that you have a lot of those. Also, if you write on a Sharpie, throw it in the freezer, that actually can be scrubbed off the next time you wash it, okay? So that's why I use them so much. So that recipe is gonna be available. I've given it to Kip. You guys go out and you can make it with blackberries, you can make it with raspberries too. But typically my favorite thing is always going to be making it with the blueberries. I think the blueberries, you can use frozen or fresh, okay? Either or, okay? That's all good. Now the last step is here, of course, now that we've rested our meat. Hey David, I'll give you that to you, buddy. The last step is to slice it, okay? Now, with of course, backstrap, it's really easy to see the proteins are going this way, right? If you've got another cut, anywhere else on your deer, okay? Make sure you're paying attention to how the protein strands run. That's another thing. We were talking about shoulders earlier. A couple gentlemen and I were talking about shoulders. I am not a fan of ground beef and jerky usage too much, okay? When we were doing our Field to Fork event, I kind of showed the guys how I actually butcher. I can actually butcher that, not a problem. I just never had shot it before. And I sat there and I cut up all my meats, and they're like looking at my cuts, and they had never seen some of them before. And they're like little mini roasts, okay? So for example, but all those little mini roasts are really easy to do, and you can have instead of just grinding it. I know the easiest thing to do is just go to grind, go to sausage, go to jerky. It's really nice if you get some beautiful medallions out of other places besides just the backstrap, by the way, okay? So our meat's now really nicely rested. So let's take a look at what it looks like on the inside. So we're gonna do a nice couple cuts. What you wanna see is that beautiful bark on the outside. There you go. It's gotta be the most even from top to bottom. Hey guys, I'm walking around. It's really hard. It's an orange tent. So you can guys see that it's really even from top to bottom, okay?
Good smoke ring.
Good smoke ring. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the smoke ring. Thank you for saying that. Who here loves a good smoke ring? Who here doesn't give a rat's ass about it? Okay, I'm going to tell you why, okay? It's pretty. That is Barbie. In our world, we call that barbecue sexy, okay? But here's the thing, and I see it on some from forums, because the internet is so full of experts, okay? We all know this, right? So basically, that smoke ring on the outside is strictly the nitrates reacting to oxygen. That's all it is. It's barbecue sexy. It's pretty as hell. But it has no effect on flavor. It has no effect on anything else. So we've got a perfectly cooked backstrap top to bottom. This one was at 124 degrees, okay? And it's been resting that whole time. So we've got a perfectly cooked reverse seared backstrap, a beautiful bark on the outside. We've got that barbecue sexy smoke ring. And that took all that time to do. But the best part, of course, is when you get to eat it, right? Who cares about how you cook it, right? You gotta eat it. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna slice this up. We're gonna give everybody a little sample, okay? Do you wanna get some forks? Maybe a pile of forks? And I'll answer any barbecue questions for you guys. How about that? Do you have any questions, sir?
Have you ever read, you took a large, say a back leg off of a white tail, rear?
Yep. Oh, heck yeah. So today, funny enough, so we're going to actually prep the shoulders right after here. I'm going to take a look at the shoulders. One of the two things that I like to wrap with, bacon. First and foremost, by the way, do not use good quality bacon. There's a reason. The lesser quality bacon is measured 18, it's called 18/24, okay? If you're ordering a restaurant case of bacon, it's called 18/24. That means it's 18 to 24 slices per pound. That's extraordinarily thin bacon. One of the biggest mistakes is we actually are trying to moisturize the meat, but I don't want to mask the flavor of the meat. Not everything venison related needs to taste like bacon. You know, that's the whole point. It's a delicious cut on its own. So 18/24 is one of the thinnest cuts you can take when it comes to bacon. And I buy the most inexpensive kind I can find. And usually that's from Restaurant Depot or Sam's Club. And that's typically a 10-pound box. You kind of got to buy a 10-pound, it's a restaurant-sized box. It's $39. I bought it many, many times. And because it's so inexpensive, that's, you know, $3.90 a pound, you can do a lot of things with it. But it's super thin. Also, they use the longest whole part of the belly, so your strips are also this long. That's another benefit if you're going to be doing a wrap, right? The second thing I love to wrap my game meats in is caul fat. You guys know what caul fat is? Okay, it's intestinal linings from pork. I want to tell you right now, it's like putting a net over meat, a fat net. If you can get your hands on pork caul fat, C-A-U-L, by the way, is the spelling. That is one of the best things you can wrap over any game meats because it actually won't detract from flavor. It's literally a netting of fat. And that'll actually elevate the flavor of it, moisturize it, because you know one of the consistent issues is tenderness and moisture, right? We want our meats to be juicy and flavorful, and I still want it to taste like venison, right? Yep, absolutely. So there's two different types of injections. There's injections for flavor, and then there's enzymatic injections. It's just like with marinades, okay? So you have the two different spectrums. Some marinades are just for flavor, and some are enzymatic or acidic based to change the pH level of the meat itself to break down those protein strands. One of the things that I love using is anything that has got bromelains in it. Now, bromelains are an enzyme found in papaya and pineapple and mangoes, okay? But with caution, let me explain to you. I once liquefied a $200 Wagyu brisket using fresh pineapple juice. You guys know who Jack LaLanne is? You remember that guy? That shows you how old I am for right there, okay? Secondly, I inherited my parents' Jack LaLanne juicer. So one day I actually liquefied and pulsed out, pulsed out an entire pineapple, put it over a brisket because I had read all the science and I thought I knew what the hell I was doing. I was wrong, okay? And one of the things is I went online and found out that, you know, these bromelains, these enzymes that were in there, were actually breaking down the meat and literally turning it to gray mush. So if you're gonna do an injection at home, make sure you use pineapple juice that's already come in a can or a jar, okay? So that it doesn't break down your meat or make it mushy. It's really a smart idea. If you're trying to do an enzyme, you actually may wanna brine your entire leg quarters or your hams. Brining is one of the most, I would more recommend brining than anything else. Who here has ever brined anything? Turkeys? I know turkeys are usually a big thing, but a lot of people forget you can brine just about everything. And what brining does is this. Okay, so you've got your cell structure, right, on your game meats. So you've got your cells and they've got so much myoglobin in them. They've got a certain water content in them. What brining does is it actually forces out, by the density of the liquid you're putting in, forces out that liquid, that myoglobin, out of the meat, replaces it with the brine. When the brine is in there, and it's usually a anywhere from a 1% to 7% salt saline solution, okay, edible, and what it does is it actually holds the moisture in there. And when it holds that moisture in there, it'll actually enable you to cook a juicier piece of meat, even if for some reason you have to overcook it, okay? You could do something like a brine over an injection, and you can still use a flavoring agent. So in regards to a brine, here's an easy recipe for a brine. 1 cup kosher salt, 1/2 cup of brown sugar, 4 tablespoons allspice berries. And by the way, that's allspice berries, whole berries. 2 gallons ice water or any other liquid, okay? And that any other liquid is anything like pineapple juice, peach juice. I love fruit juices with venison. I really do. I love the fruit juices, okay? And you want to brine 1 hour per pound. So if you've got something that's 2 to 3 pounds, you should be brining 2 to 3 hours, okay? Same with turkey. Same thing there. I don't know if there's any turkey hunters in here, but yeah, it's the same brine I use for that. There you go. Pardon me? Oh, yeah, no problem. 1 cup kosher salt. And by the way, just a note about kosher salts. Not all kosher salts are equal. You need to understand that if you buy a box of Morton's kosher salt versus Diamond Crystal versus Diamond Flake Crystal versus Redmond salt, all of them have different sodium levels on them. If you're looking for a comparison, you're looking for a lower sodium option, go to cooksillustrated.com. They've actually got a chart that lists all the sodium contents. I will typically, when I'm doing brining, I use Morton's kosher salt. It comes in the black box. You know why I use it? Because I can always find it at Walmart. It's easy to find nationwide. And because I teach all over the nation, I need to make sure that here to there, you know, not everybody's got a Publix. Not everybody has an Ingles, you know, Kroger. So I always try to pick products that everybody can get nationwide, okay? So 1 cup, yeah, 1 cup of Morton's kosher salt, 1/2 cup of brown sugar, 4 tablespoons allspice berries. I like allspice berries because they're not as aggressive as cinnamon, but they give a warmth overall to the actual brine flavor. And you're gonna go to 2 gallons of liquid, whether it be peach juice or whatever.
Again, what's the ratio?
1 hour per pound. Yes, ma'am.
We'll try to get that on the website as well.
We can probably do that.
Is that in your book?
Yes, of course it is. 5 essential recipes at the front.
Yeah. Yep. The book, actually, we have some here.
I think I have 20 here. Tomorrow we're going to make that available, I think, right? Yeah. Yeah, at the convention center. So, last thing. You guys notice I've got this beautiful pile of absolutely gorgeous venison now, right? Your end pieces, you notice the end pieces? They're always gonna be 4 to 5 degrees over. They're thinner, you can't avoid it. Just share them with a friend. There you go, okay? The last thing you wanna do before you serve it out and drizzle on some beautiful blueberry sauce, you need to go back, seasoning, and re-season your meat. This isn't a chef-y thing, there's a reason for this. Earlier I said one of the reasons I don't like seasoning right before or right overnight is because the second you hit anything with salt, it draws out moisture. Well, if you're serving something at home, that little bit of kick of salt, you know, it's like when we make mashed potatoes at home, right? What do we add to mashed potatoes? Butter, salt, pepper. Well, it's the same with meat. You should always add a little sprinkle of salt or a sprinkle of barbecue seasoning. The reason is that water will come to the surface of the meat immediately. And that means more flavor comes to the surface of the meat, and that's what's touching your tongue first, okay? All right, so we've just salted that. We're gonna toss it with the leftover juices that are there. We've got a beautiful pile of perfectly reverse seared meat. Gorgeous backstrap. And because Bearded Buck doesn't do vegetables, I'm gonna put his two pieces on the side. I learned that in Pennsylvania too. He doesn't do any vegetables at all. And apparently blueberry's a vegetable. Seriously, I am not kidding you. It took me 2 hours to give it to him just to try it. So once you have all your meat, take your drizzle all over there. Also, additionally, by the way, I'm a messy server at my house. David's eaten at my house, and him and his wife have eaten at my house many, many times. I literally love to lay out butcher paper. So I'm literally piling stuff up, okay? If you want a 5-star service, you should not come to my house. If you want to eat well, come to my house. All right? And literally, that is it. That is reverse seared backstrap with a blueberry. And because we're going to make it fancy because he gets the nice pictures, okay? Because, you know, when the camera and the social media is out, you know, you got to make it pretty. Okay? We've got some blueberries. And that is reverse seared backstrap with blueberry. Hold on, I'm not done yet. Come on. I'm not afraid to argue with him now, okay? I don't think I was afraid before, but, you know.
I will say while she's doing it, that I did have the pleasure of guiding Danielle on her first
And it was awesome. And we've been friends ever since.
There's a lot of takeaways from that. And partially...